Y'all stand outside to help y'all stand up.
Yes.
Y'all be like, there you go. Especially Vendita.
Amen.
Vendita. That's her name?
Yes, it is. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to change out microphones. I think you got to come back up. The two of you got to come back up and give them the announcement. Hello, you two. Hello, lovely married couple. Let's go. Let's go. Come on, we all pushing now. Let's go. Come on up here. Come on up here.
He was always playing hockey.
He's trying to give me the hockey.
Come up here. Stay up here.
The bridge boy.
They all shine, blushing like this guy.
Always something.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
We love y'all.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And we want to bring to y'all that we want to start a Bible class here. Wednesday at 6:30, if that's convenient. Wednesday, 6:30.
Amen.
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 So we're going to get that moving right along weekly, 6:30, Bible class, myself or my husband, you know, my situation. Amen.
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 Amen. She has spoken.
Amen. I don't know why they're so shy. See, I'm going to tell it because I think it's a great thing.
Yeah.
It had been in my heart, you know, the both of them has been in my heart. You know, I told Rick and Jesse that, you know, why don't you give thought about doing something ministry-wise during the week because the church is all closed up, you know? And he smiled. It was yesterday too, right? And we were outside giving out cards to people who were walking by, and he called his bride, and I spoke to her on the phone, and it was like her and I was on the same page that God had spoken to her about doing more. So she was just gushing forth. Yes, thank you, Pastor. And it just done my heart good. Like Reverend Jesse said also is that he sees the growth in all of us. And that's what it's all about. And I'm looking forward to seeing the growth in the two of you. It happens like that. So, you know, when God is ready, you know, he's going to drop the right situation in your lap. And you never know what God can do. I'm telling you, I've seen Francine, who was like a wallflower. Now I don't even think her mother thought she could sing so good until one Sunday she got up here and bust out a note.
Amen.
Now look at her now. She's a force to be reckoned with.
Yes, she is.
And Mother Sills, I can't get Mother Sills to stop. Okay, but I remember she's our internet star. She gets more hits on the internet than everybody else combined. And when I first met her, she was a shy little thing in the corner. Mm-hmm. You know, she was just, well, Fred, what did Fred say? It was her husband, you know? And she just was quiet. But now, if Fred could see her, he'd be amazed. And I'm sure he's seen her. I'm sure he's very proud because it's also what Fred poured into her.
Amen.
Amen.
You know? So just like I saw those others come up, you know, shortly, I think I'm going to see the same in the two of you, and I'm prophesying.
Amen.
And I tease with Reverend Jesse that it would be embarrassing if y'all get bigger than I am.
I know.
Who cares? That's my job.
We're not greater than the master.
That's my job to equip and to enable. That's my job, you know? That's what I do. And I want to see that. Because I'll be bragging, I'll be like, there they go, see them on TV? I got the tape, I'm going to prove it. You don't know what God can do, because he can bring these wonderful people who are awesome women of God into such greatness. What more he gonna do with y'all who are already equipped and put together already?
Amen.
Trust him on this.
Amen.
Some days it's gonna be cold. Some days you ain't wanna come out, but come out anyhow. Please, and watch what God do.
Amen.
And the thing is that, and y'all know this already, but I'm gonna remind you, once you start taking care of God's work, what does he do?
He takes care of yours.
That's right.
Amen.
But he was gonna need that one thing that you really need. Because he wants you to go deeper. Because sometimes when he bless you completely too quickly, we get conceited.
Yep.
Right. Right. Yeah, it's about me. I'm gonna moonwalk to the stand. No. That's gonna be in trouble. So he gonna need one little thing out that you need that you probably will never get because he wants your full attention.
Yeah.
But everything else,
amen.
You gonna have.
Amen.
And that's what he does. Amen.
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 So let's look in the Word of God. We're going to turn our Bibles to the book of John. I like the book of John because if I had to choose one Bible, one book of the Bible to live the rest of my life with, it would be the book of John. Mm-hmm. Why? Because he begins in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Huh? So, you know, that's your Genesis right there. And he speaks of Jesus in such a spiritual way. It's one of the most spiritual books in the Bible. John was very spiritual. That's why John was trusted with the book of Revelation. So spirituality, being spiritual, God would trust you with some very deep things.
Amen.
You know, Paul was intellectual. God trusted him with some smart things, you know. Peter could fight and wouldn't budge. That's why he was the rock.
Right.
Amen? Amen. But John was spiritual, and that's why he was trusted with the mysterious things. So whatever gift God gave you, it's as good as anybody else's.
Amen.
He's going to stand apart. Amen?
Amen.
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 Let's read chapter 14, mm-hmm. verses 1-7. Amen. Let's stand and read the Word of God. Come on, don't be standing for me, stand for the Word of God.
Amen.
And I'll read chapter 14, verses 1-7. Mm-hmm. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may also be. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye would have also known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. Father, we thank you for your word. We bless you. We magnify you. We adore you. We lift you up. We give you the praise and the honor and the glory. Lord, I'm asking that minds be opened and hearts be opened too, O Father God. And hearts receive, O Lord, your word and your instructions for us. We love you, Lord. We magnify you and we adore you. And in your holy name we say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. I'm going to focus on chapter 6 where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Yes, yes, yes.
Jesus said these things and he was, I believe, trying to say these things all along to us. That he is what we need to get what we need to get. But sometimes it takes a doubting person and there's always some doubt that we have. And it's okay to doubt because sometimes I doubt the Lord. Lord, did you really say I'm going to be happy?
Yeah.
Lord, did you really say you're going to send the one for me? Mm-hmm. Lord, did you really say I'm not going to be lacking for nothing, but these bills are long and mm-hmm. my money is short. Lord, did you say this? Lord, did you say that? And then we doubt, but the problem is not just doubting. The problem is doubting and not giving your doubt to the Lord. And when Thomas gave his doubt to the Lord answered him. So the things that you doubt, the things that you think is not going to happen, you don't give it to nobody else. And the worst thing you can do is keep it into your heart. Why? It would burn your heart out. It would stress you out. But Thomas was smart enough to give it to the Lord.
Amen.
The doubt you have, give to the Lord.
Yeah.
I know we have doubts. Lord, am I going to be delivered?
That's right. Huh? Yes,
you can be a gifted man and woman of God, but yet be beholden to something else.
Yes,
isn't that true?
Amen.
You can be laying hands on people, healing them, talking to people, relieving their doubt, right?
Yes, huh? Amen. Yes.
Singing and people get happy, but then you go home and you cry. But what you do, you don't sit there. You don't worry about it. You give it to the Lord. Lord, I got an issue. Lord, help me out of my circumstance. And that's where the power comes from, because we can't do it all by ourselves. We need the Lord. We can't do it. We're not able. We're not made that way. Because after God squoze Adam from the ground, from clay, yet he looked like a human being, right? But it was not until God breathed his life into him that Adam became a living soul. So while you're standing there with feet of clay, and you can't get the situation going, and you're frozen in time, and you cannot move. Sometimes the Bible says that what you can do is just to stand sometime and see the glory of God, what he will do for you. That's why it's not a bad thing to doubt. It's a bad thing to doubt and to not cast your cares upon him. Why? Because he cares for you. Amen? And Jesus says to Thomas, I am the way.
Yeah.
And the truth.
Oh, yeah.
And the life.
Yeah.
Now, I love the King James Bible, but sometimes I think they don't get deep enough for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because when I looked at the word the way in the Greek, it means hodos. And hodos, it means that I am the process.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, Jesus, he has a name, but he's saying I'm a function. Back in the day, there was a hairstyle men used called a process.
Yeah.
We are far gone, Reverend Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
For many reasons, right? They ain't the style no more, number one.
Right.
Number two, y'all mind your business. But anyway,
that's right.
And when I was a kid, I would see like grown men, they would process the hair and tie it in the middle, right?
Yes.
And have like a little pompadour sticking out on the top, right? Everybody had that, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And listen, they laughing. They had Jerry curls, okay?
That's right.
And then box haircuts on top. What is that? But let them go ahead. Every generation has its own thing.
Process.
And they call that thing a process.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Yes.
But it was a thing. But it was a process because they had to get the lie. They had to get the hair straightener and put it into the hair to get to that situation which they thought they were beautiful.
Yes.
The same with Jesus. He's a process. We might call him Jesus. We might call upon his name. But he's a process. He's the means for us to get what we want.
Yes.
Just like Thomas cried out to him and said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. And Jesus, he will tell you.
Yes.
So just by asking Jesus what you want, the process begins.
Oh, yeah.
To get that process into their hair, they had to wash and clean and do this and leave it on because it's about to burn and rinse it out. And because it's a process. That's the same way that Jesus will do to us. That if we want to be beautiful, if we want to be in season and out season, there's no other way to get it done but through this process. So we gotta recognize Jesus as not just an entity sitting there looking good in our wall, or somebody in the Bible, or the name you want to call them, but you understand it's a process. Jesus is like a warm, purifying pool. We gotta step into Jesus when things are wrong, you know, and all of a sudden we feel soothed. That's Jesus. God is a spirit. You see, so it's not a thing. It's a thing that we can't sense. That's why he transforms people. Another thing for Jesus then is sanctification. Maybe we should call him that. Sanctification, because it's by his stripes we are what? Healed. The process of Jesus is amazing, because we see the process of Jesus when people came to be healed. It was not so much the power of Jesus that healed people. There are many times the Bible said that he went places that he could not heal people. Because they didn't believe.
That's right.
So it's the process of coming to Jesus, of your faith in action, that makes you healed. It was the process of that woman who had the issue of blood to push through that crowd to get to Jesus that made her healed. Jesus was there for 33 and 30 years, and nothing could get done until they were recognizing who he really is. And they pushed on, she pushed on through. And what did she do? She didn't get in his face. She didn't have to make no big prayer. She didn't have to give him $1,000 and get a prayer cloth. All she had to do is touch the hem of his garment. She didn't need his full attention. And what happened to her? Her situation that she spent all her money on for all those other years was done in an instant. That's the process of Jesus. And there's another process of Jesus when they had the 5 loaves and the fishes. That's a process for you. And the Bible says it took a little boy's lunch and handed it out in baskets. And the baskets came back. You can read it this way, that when the baskets went out, though they were hungry, they put what they had in the basket because of the process. That they were no longer hungry. That they saw what they needed. And they had enough because of Jesus. And they put what they had in that basket and gave back even more. And that's what Jesus does to you. He takes that thing that you had as a hunger and he turns you around and he fixes you up and he enables you to give unto other people's business. That's the process of Jesus. He's going to turn you around. He says, you are not the tail, but you shall be the head. You shall not be a beggar, but what? A lender, not a borrower. That's the process of Jesus. He's going to turn who was a killer into a life giver. There was a woman and the woman at the well, and she had a situation.
Yeah.
And her situation was what? She had how many?
Five
husbands. Amen. Thank you, Reverend Jesse.
Amen.
That's not so bad these days, right? But it's when she got up in front of Jesus' face, she understood, you know, who he was, and she was honest enough to tell him about our situation. That's another reason why we don't get into the process of Jesus, because we won't tell the truth. We won't tell the truth about our circumstances. We won't say, God, it's me, I'm a pervert. We're not going to say that, right? Come on. We're not going to say, Lord, I drink too much alcohol. Come on now. We're not going to say, Lord, I got anger issues.
Yeah.
We're not going to say that. We're not going to say, Lord, I'm a spendthrift. But if you just say to him that I need you right now and the pardon of our sins, the process begins. And what happened to that woman after a while? She went back to her town and told people what the Lord had done. A woman in need is not given to other people. She was given, what she was given wasn't working for her. But when she saw Jesus, she gave something that was better for people. So what the Lord gives you is not just for yourself, it's for other people.
Yes.
It's the way the way he works.
Yes.
There's also the process we can see through the man at the pool of Bethesda.
Yes.
Now how long was he there? And he was a believer.
Amen.
But he believed in angels. You see, he didn't believe in the power of God.
Mm-hmm.
He thought that an angel is going to come down.
Lord,
yeah.
Right.
There's a song. Like I said, send me an angel. Mm-hmm. You know, would you send me an angel?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sometimes we get like that. Lord, send me an angel. Let somebody knock on my door with a bag of money, right?
That's right.
Don't we do that?
Right.
But see, he believed, but he didn't believe on Jesus. He didn't believe on the process. But he had a sense of what belief is all about. But he misplaced it, and sometimes we're like that. Because sometimes it's easy to wait upon an angel. Huh? Sometimes it's easy because we want God to send somebody to send the thing. Meanwhile, we have direct access to the process. And when Jesus showed up in that man's life, he said, will thou be made whole? And it didn't take forever. He pulled the man up and the man walked instantly.
Yeah.
So while we're busy looking for an angel, while we're busy thinking it's going to come and do somebody else, while we're busy thinking that it's a problem with the finances, while we're busy thinking that we can't find a man or that we can't find a woman or what somebody else is doing or not doing is the problem, while we're too busy worrying about this, that, and the other, while we're too busy worrying and waiting for some miracle to happen, we just got to call out to Jesus. That's all we have to do. He's the process. And the process for these people didn't take 15, 20 years. What happened? It was instantaneous.
Yes.
I've learned so in so little stupid ways how great God is.
Yes. Thank you.
Somebody gave me a washing machine.
Thank you.
I wonder why. But they gave me a washing machine, right? And the thing wouldn't work. And I'm giving you a regular day-to-day example, but that's how the devil gets you. He don't always get you a big calamity.
Mm-hmm.
The calamity is when he got you in the corner and when you gave up everything, you know? But he gets you with the little stupid things. Like, I won't trust God for a washing machine to work. So how am I going to trust God to other things in my life?
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
If you can't be trusted with little, you can't be trusted with too much. The thing was broken. But I prayed, Lord, let this washing machine work. Don't laugh. And the washing machine is working. The repairing man came and said it's working. God does those things. And I've learned to trust him in the small little things. Because, if you see, sometimes we got to reverse. We can pray to God for the big things.
Right.
I will pray to God for the big problems. And because I don't pray to God on my problems. Because you can read, you can worship. But are you really praying to God? Are you really being intimate with him? Because let's say you're dating somebody. You're even married, right? And you can do the big things. You're in the same house. You know, everything is going well, but you don't talk to that person.
Right.
You don't tell that person what's going on in your life.
Right.
They don't know what hurt your heart.
Right.
They don't know how your day went.
Mm-hmm.
What's the quality of that relationship? It's not too good. A friend of mine said something that blew my mind. He said that he wouldn't mind if his wife had an affair. That wouldn't bother him so much. But he was worried about the person who she gave her heart to, the person who she speaks to. He said, that's where it's gone. That's where it's over. You see, and the same is God. The same it is with God. He ain't worried about how we act bad all the time. Because you see, when you have a close and intimate relationship with the Lord, all those things are going to fall off you anyhow. You're going to get it straight anyway. But if you're not going to trust God with a little intimate thing, like your washing machine ain't working, or like your toe hurt, or like you got bad dad, whatever it could be, you can't find a parking space, or anything, any little thing in your life. And if you're not focusing on the Lord for those little things, there's no real intimacy between you and the Lord.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's not.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is that how he prepares us to do the big deliverance miracle power is the small miracles.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're like hands on the griddle. He's throwing crumbs out.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. It's like the manna.
Yes.
In the morning. Mm-hmm. You know? But you gotta go out and pick up the little trifling things. Yeah. You gotta pick them up. Mm.
Yes.
And after you get the manna in the morning, what happens at night? The fire.
Fire, that's right.
You see your way through the darkness, and then that's how you gotta deal with the Lord. So Jesus said he is the way. He's saying he wants a close, tight relationship with you. And that's why we are called the what? The bride of Christ.
That's right.
So when we're married to the Lord, we gotta tell him each and everything that is bothering you, no matter how small, no matter how large, you gotta tell him how your day was, you gotta tell him what was bothering you. You gotta talk to him. Sometimes you just gotta even think on him. Sometimes you don't want to speak it out loud. You don't have to. Think on these things and all the peace that passes all understanding shall guard your heart and minds through whom? Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus said, and I'm not going to tarry long, he said that I am the truth.
The truth.
The way, the truth, and the life. He said, I'm the truth.
Yes.
And Medina is here for a reason, because that word truth in Hebrew is called aletheia. That's the word, aletheia. And you see, in the King James they use the word truth, but it's not the best way to grasp it, because by aletheia it means I'm the unconcealment. You see, truth means that I'm the accurate depiction of what is before us. That's true. Okay? That's describing reality or creation. But Jesus says, I'm the reason behind the creation.
Yes.
He's saying that the problem that you have is a Jesus problem.
Yes.
What he's saying that I am the meaning of life.
Yes.
People be talking about, I want what's life all about?
Yes.
Why am I here? Why they make me? Sometimes we worry about why they make me so black.
Mm-hmm.
And white people, why they make me so white and pink? You know? Huh? Why they make me too tall? Why they make me too short? Shut your mouth. Jesus made you. And that's the good thing. And he made you for a reason. And the thing is that when you get to Jesus, he's going to reveal to you why. He's going to tell you why he made you exactly the way he made you. Because he has a blessing for you. They call it a rhema word. That is perfectly detailed to your situation. And that's why he's a personal God. Because he has something that nobody else can give Francine. It is made for Francine. Every nook and cranny is Francine's. It's like that coat of many colors that they put on Joseph. Because it was made for him and nobody else. That's what he does, and it's like the priestly garments that he gave Moses' brother who was totally no good. That's how God does, because even though we ain't no good, even though we can be stuck up conceited just like Joseph, he's still going to love us in a way that nobody else can understand. That's not going to make sense to nobody, but he's the thing that you've been looking for, and that's what it means by he saying, I am the truth.
Yes.
I am your truth.
Yes.
I'm here for you.
Amen.
You are not lost in the sauce. You are not just a thing punched out by a factory. Everybody looks alike, one size fit all. He said, I have something just for you. And that nobody else can have. It's not for them. He says, I am after you and you alone. He said in your word that as a shepherd, you gladly leave the 100 and do what? The 99 do what? And look for you.
Yes.
That's how much he loved you.
Yeah.
That's how much he wants you. So every question that's in your mind, every doubt, everything that you think you need, it's going to be satisfied through the Lord. He's the one who's going to do it right. Sometimes seeing the answer is not so hot either. We got to watch this sometime because there was a time when I spoke about Mother Teresa, who said she went through like 50 years of darkness. Now she was serving people. I think there was, I can't remember a human being as great as Mother Teresa. She's a great sister, come on. Because she's in a fourth world country feeding people with no money. I'm worried about my grocery bill, right? And she's feeding people with no money. But she said, she had another problem that she could not pray all those years. That she lived in darkness. They call it aridity. It's a state where you are so wounded that you have no connection to God. And sometimes Jesus will do you like that, because he's saying that sometimes that you can do this with just a direct connection from God. So sometimes he will put you out there and you think you can't do it. And you feel sometimes that he's not talking to you, but that is what you need to move ahead, because he did not want her dependent upon him. Sometimes he's going to do you like that. He's going to put you out there. And the secret he's trying to show her is that she's ready.
Yes.
And that's what holds us back, because he's going to unconceal the fact that we're ready. And what we're going to hold on to is our doubt. Like Thomas, back to square one. And then you got to show you again that he's the way. Back to kindergarten. And then you get back to the truth. And that's how he does you. And lastly, he says, I'm the life. John 1:1 describes this. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And through him. In Greek philosophy, they have Atlas, holy of the world, right?
That's right.
But you see, they're trying to take what is of God and what is spiritual and make it into a pagan thing, but it's Jesus in which every living thing has its being.
Right.
So while you're worrying about whether or not this is the right way, or whether or not this is your truth, you got to remember that it's Jesus that's responsible for all of it anyhow. And that's where you get to the point where you really operate at a high spiritual level, when you recognize that it's all about Jesus.
That's right.
It's all about that creature who was so ugly. I know we like to look at him like he's like what Michelangelo made.
Mm-hmm.
My mother, grandmother, he looked like what I say, Brad Pitt with a weave. But Josephus saw Jesus, and there's a version of Josephus's writings who saw an eyewitness depiction of Jesus, and he said he was short. He was black. He had a big nose. And he was a hunchback. So he was an ugly thing. And that's the way God does it. He's not going to come to you beautiful looking like David.
Right.
He's not going to come to you looking good like Beyonce. He's not going to look like $1 million in a big bag. He's not going to come to you like that. But here's what Isaiah said, that he had no beauty that we would honor him.
Right.
And he was a man of many sorrows. See, this is the thing. So life is like that too. Life can be very ugly. Life can be a thing that you don't expect. Life can be a thing that you just don't want. Life can be a thing that you say, no way, that's for me. But it's through these things that you move and have your being. And that's why we as Christians are made to walk by faith and not by what? Sight. And when you walk by faith, you're walking in the way. You're going through the process. And then you realize that this thing is the tale for you, that you are not alone, that God has you in the palm of his hand, and that life is all about you being the bride of Christ. And it's he who keeps those stars hanging in the sky. In Genesis 1:1, the way the Jews say, I like it. We read, in the beginning God, but they read it this way, in beginning his march to your heart, God created the heavens and the earth. So he put those stars in the sky to show you he loved you. That's what those stars are for. That's what the flowers are for. That's what the ribbons and all these other things. They're just like an engagement ring. I'm of God. And every time you look at your finger, you see how much that man or woman loved you. And that's what God is saying. I love you so much that I created everything that you see. It's through Jesus. So don't deny him. Become more spiritual. I was speaking to Reverend Jesse the other day that we have to become more spiritual. Right. We can't forget about the things like clapping your hands and shouting. Speaking in tongues, you have to do it. If you don't have it, you have to learn it. Many times I'm going through my problems, I'm glad I learned it years ago. I was just talking tongues and I don't know what to say. Your heart could be broken. And I'm going to say some stupidness, like Lord strike up with lightning. You know? But when you talk in tongues, you give your spirit utterance, you know? Your spirit man talks, what's within you talks. And sometimes it's not what the conscious mind thinks.
That's right.
We don't know everything. So when you speak in tongues, you're saying also, I don't know everything.
That's right.
And I want to be spiritual. Yeah. I don't want to use natural language.
Right.
We know how even the Bible can trick us because to the final meaning.
Yeah.
It's the same way. I'm going to go after God with everything I have within me. Do it. You will get through.
Yes.
Fight the good fight. What did Paul say? That he has run this race. He has fought the good fight. And that's all you have to do.
Yes.
You don't even have to know it all. Just remember, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And he will do it for you. And we got things we want to get done. And if you just hold on to Jesus' hand, if we raise the level of our spirituality, if we just talk to him constantly, watch how things happen. We have not why because we ask not. Ask him. He's the way. He's the truth. And he's the life. Amen? Amen. I'm done. Lord, we thank you. We love you. We adore you. We lift you up. We give you the praise and the honor and the glory. We thank you for what you're doing for us and what you will do, O Father God. We thank you for our lives. We thank you for your life, O Father God. We thank you for all that you're doing, Jesus. Lord, we need you right now. Lord, we have problems that we can't even count. Lord, when we give it one problem, two more drop up in front of our faces, O Father God. But Lord, let us not see the world through the lens of problems, but through you, O God. We understand that you, O Father God, are just not a name, but you're a process. You're the means in which our problems will be solved, God. Let us learn to give our problems up to the Lord, O Father God, Jesus, Lord. Let us do like he told Malachi. Write it down. Make the vision plain that he who read it can run with it. In Jesus' name, let us do these things. Lord, we love you, we thank you, we adore you. And in your holy name we say, amen.
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 Thank you.